Okay, hi everyone. Thanks for coming to yet another installment of the IxD Session. I think there are a lot of you guys here are new, right? First time.
Wow, then I got no place to sit.
Okay, wow. give me. I wanted to get out.
Okay, so we have been, for those who are new, IxD really stands for Interaction Design Association.
I don't have pockets.
If you Google IxD, you'll hit up to the global IxD website. So IxDA is actually a global non-profit. We have a lot of chapters all around the world, and they're all run by volunteers. Right? So we run meetups like this, especially for me, is really to provide a platform for everyone to network, learn from talented people, right? And to find jobs and find talents to hire. This format of the meetup, which is the IxDA, the conversation kind of style. We started it in last April, and that was with IDBS with David Travis, which is a prominent UK UX guy. And we are in April again, right? So it's been over a year. So yeah, I'm glad we sustained through. Round of applause. Yeah, we know running meetups is not easy, so running consistently over a year is, yeah. Okay, so thanks a lot for coming to Zendesk, and we are so glad that they actually sponsored all the food and the venue. And you also notice there's Michael Chen here, right? What's Michael doing here? So, they are from Engineers.SG, so they have also volunteered to help record this session, and you can basically check on Engineers.SG for a recap of what this session is all about. Okay, so today we have a rooster. Why is a rooster here?
Yeah, it just is.
Okay, so today we have Mike and Shiyun from Zendesk here. So Mike is.
Oh, yeah, I'm a designer at Zendesk.
And I'm also is this working? And I'm also a designer at Zendesk. So.
Right. Okay, so we're gonna get the conversation started. Okay, so for those who have been here the first time, right, you'll notice that this is a no presentation kind of format. That means if you're here the last time, any presentation, sorry, there's no screen, no projector here. Right. It's really a conversation style, talk show format. So the value of it is really based on the questions that you ask, right? If you just sit there and keep it, nothing will happen. Yeah. So if there are any burning questions, just feel free to throw it out. This is the time to tap on their brains. Yeah. Okay?
Yeah. And our design team over there wants us to remind everyone that they are going to give out swag for any questions that are being asked.
Good
ask more questions. Yes.
Good questions.
Ask more questions.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to just start the ball rolling. Yeah. So
sure.
Mike and Siri, would you just tell us a little bit about how you guys, what's your journey so far?
How in-depth do you want to be?
20 years again.
Okay, I was born in 90. Okay, I guess like how I got here was like a mix of lucky coincidences. Okay, from the start, I was born in China and became a naturalized Singaporean. I grew up in the UK. My dad was an electrical engineer, researcher in Liverpool. And so my childhood was spent a lot of time after school, like I go to his lab, and there's a lot of computers everywhere, and like he would teach me how to operate the computer, like how to play solitaire, and sometimes even like play around with the soldering iron and all that kind of stuff. Which I wonder why I didn't become an engineer. So I guess I was lucky in a sense that I was exposed to computers very early, and that really helped to cultivate an interest in that from a young age. Ever since then, just been a geek or a nerd, playing with computers. Like, started out doing Q Basic, and then after that HTML. So at the time, there wasn't CSS yet. And you had to design using tables and all that kind of stuff.
GIFs, right?
My favorite, GIFs. Yeah. I didn't have enough bandwidth to make GIFs and all. But the most impressive thing you could do was like a marquee blinking tag, right? In school, during art class, they had Photoshop lessons. I happened to breeze through those lessons and just like kept interest in it. Like after school, I just like keep playing with this tool. Got the friendly student version and just keep like working on some websites and coding it up. When I got to university, I was quite undecided about where I like my career would be. So I was quite I had this interest in sociology, philosophy, the arts and humanities side of things. But at the same time, I liked technology and computers. So it wasn't until I took this class called user experience, that's when I realized that you can actually have a career where you can work in a cross-functional team, and build products and make a career out of that. So it kind of like exposed me to you can marry these two like interests and get paid at the same time. Like, sounds like a good deal. So that was a lucky break, and another lucky break was there was an internship program in NUS, and they send you to some a company in the US, and it was originally for media, so Hollywood, animation and all that kind of stuff. And then I asked, hey, website design is new media, right? I said, yeah, okay. Then my friend said there's a startup doing accounting software, they need a designer. Then I just applied for that. And it's sort of like hacking the system. So I got an internship, and they got an intern that was being paid for by the school, so it's free. I didn't do terribly well during my interview. They kind of just took a chance on me because I was free. So yeah, I later asked them about it. Yeah, that's what they told me. Got lucky. People were kind in my career, and that's how I got my lucky break in the industry. Then after that, I was working with them for close to 2 years, and one of my uni friends, he quit his job and said, hey, we should start a company, right? Because it's what we always talk about during our Starbucks sessions in school, like, hey, we should start a company, it'll be cool, and then we can be our own boss and all that kind of stuff. And that's what we did. Go online to Accra, pay $20, and there we are, we are in business now. So they didn't tell me about all the accounting and bookkeeping I had to do. We built a design business out of that called Minitheory, and did that for 4 years. After that, felt like it was time for a change. So after that, went on a sabbatical, trying to see what's next for me. I had kids during that time also, so it was quite coincidental. Yeah, I had twins.
Okay, yeah, that was almost 20 years.
Yeah. Correct.
So, you mean, how did you came about?
20 years ago, I was in.
So young.
I guess I got started. I got started when I got like close to a bunch of friends who were very much into technology, and then they were very much into the web thing, and I thought their designs were terrible, so I just became the designer. They're all in US. They're all in the States now, but yeah, that it was a lot thanks to them that I got into the design. So when it came to choosing university courses, I love math and science as a kid, and I was just like, oh, I like math and science, but I really like design. So what could I do? So I picked this very weird course called Information Engineering and Media. I know there are a couple of students over there. I picked this weird course called Information Engineering and Media from NTU. So I studied that, I became an engineer, and then by the time I graduated, I decided I didn't want to be an engineer. So why I picked that course was because they advertised this media component, like you will mostly learn to be an engineer, but 20% of your time you can go and do media stuff. And I was like, oh yeah, that's cool, that sounds like me, I want to do media-ish stuff. But by the time I graduated, I was like, no, I don't want to be an engineer anymore, so I just want to be a designer. So I applied to this company called Zobim 4 years ago. So I came for an interview. The office was super dodgy. The lights were all off. No one was wearing shoes. People were shouting across the room. It was terrifying. But I met my interviewers. I think they are somewhere, but yeah. One of my interviewers, he's now in the States. He's still working in the same company. So I met two really good interviewers who convinced me that, this company looks super dodge. They have no lights on. People are shouting across the room, but they actually know what they were doing. So after a terribly grueling interview process, whereby I remember one of the sessions was like 3 hours long, they just kept me in the room. And they didn't seem to know like how to interview people, and just like, okay, draw something for me. And I'm like, what? Draw something for you? What? That was extremely intimidating. But talking to them made me feel like, yeah, I think these people know what they wanted to do. So I joined the company, and 4 years later, I still am here. By the way, my 4-year anniversary is this Saturday. So yeah.
So in case. For those of you who don't know, Zobim is acquired by Zendesk.
We got acquired by Zendesk 2 or 3 years ago. I can't remember now. 2 or 3 years ago.
Yeah. Right. Okay. So, now one came from a design studio, own business into Zendesk, and you came all the way from, like, this is your first job?
Yes.
From the start all the way now into Zendesk. How different has it been in the chain of life right now?
You? Who? Guess I'll go first. Environment is very different. The first thing is that I can actually do design now. Because as a business owner last time, I was just... I fired myself from a lot of different jobs. Like, I was a designer, then I was like the PM, and then I became more of like the business person, plus the spokesperson and the company mascot and the person like getting deals in and all that. And what I really want to do is to get back to basics, get back into doing design. So personally, that's been the biggest difference. I can actually work on stuff now. And I guess the other difference is that now we're in a bigger company, I can't just mouth off what I want to say. Coming from a small company, it's very easy to have nice relationships with colleagues when you're all in the same room. But now, we are an international company, right? It takes more effort. It takes, you got to have the intention and the attitude to want to connect with people from different offices and across different time zones and all that. And I believe this is like a common theme across multinational companies in general. But it takes effort and you've got to do it, It's a bit like after school, it's a bit harder to keep in touch with all your friends. It takes a special effort to go and do it rather than like y'all be in the same like going for classes and all that. So yeah, that's kind of like the metaphor and what it's been like for me.
Essentially, relationships are complicated. That's the Zendesk tagline, by the way. Yes, very important. I don't really know how to articulate the differences very well. This is my first job. After all, I don't have a lot to compare. I would say, I guess in a startup environment, things are a lot more personal. You go by relationships, it feels a lot more intimate. It's a lot more personal. It's also a lot more disorganized and chaotic. After getting acquired by Zendesk, I think things are still pretty chaotic, but we try to make it more organized. And this whole relationships thing, I think what Mike said is pretty true. Like, it's very hard to work. You have to put in extra effort to build those relationships when working with someone that you cannot see on a daily basis. So that part, I think, is a big, it's a big factor in our work right now. Like, you really have to make extra effort to build those relationships. But in a small startup environment, it's like, you see that guy every day, of course you're close with him. So I guess that's the biggest difference for me.
I guess there's a similarity, right? You guys still don't wear shoes, right?
we still don't wear shoes on that side of the office, but this side, because it's like, sales and we have a lot of visitors, that's why this site is shoe zone. Pantry is also shoe zone because we have a lot of visitors. Yeah.
Okay, so one more question before we kind of like throw it down to the floor, I guess, right? Everyone is eager to ask. I wanted to know how is the team composed of and how are they being, how do they work within Zendesk?
So we have we are part of a global team of 20 plus designers. Each office has its own product, and in Singapore, we have one of the biggest teams consisting of five designers and two researchers. Essentially, locally, how we break down is each designer is attached to a Scrum team and work very closely with within a Scrum team. Like, so the Scrum team consists of about typically 6 to 8 engineers and one PM. The division is, can be by products, like from a message and one of the products being worked on here. Chat is like pretty big, so it's being divided by Rumble Enterprise, mobile, the customer like facing like widget. And our core like chat, yeah.
Anything so it's like sub products from the main product.
Yeah, like areas of focus essentially.
Okay.
Yeah.
And when you say PM, it's product managers or
product managers.
Product managers. Yeah. So there are individual product managers leading the Scrum team.
Yeah.
Of 6 to 8 engineers.
Yeah. Exactly.
Okay.
So basically, the product manager acts as the person who interprets like the business goals of Zendesk, and then thinking about in order to like meet certain business goals, be it revenue goals or like entering into a new market, like what kind of features that we need to build in order to achieve that goal. Anything to add?
Whatever he said. Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
Good teamwork.
So over on the floor, any questions so far? Yes.
So a huge part about the client server side is getting feedback from your users and stuff for your website. So what kind of feedback do you get and how do you actually get it? Yeah.
Me? You?
That's an interesting question. So a lot of our users I think majority of Zendesk users are actually not based in Singapore. So we know a lot of schools of thought tell you like, oh, you go you go find your users, you must observe them at work, you must like watch them, how they are using your products and whatnot. It's actually very challenging for us to do that here. So we do a lot of user interviews. We try to make use of data. We're not very good at making use of data yet, but we try to make use of data as much as we can. We do a lot of user interviews, we do surveys. We make use of our own products to get user feedback as well. I mean, clearly we are a customer relationship software, so we would obviously use our own products. We have this thing called the serving party, whereby we go, we rotate and go and serve chats ourselves, for example. We also like have people serving tickets. We have engineers going on who use the support product to serve tickets. Our PMs monitor the helps and monitor our forums. So to your question about like how we get user feedback, it's through a lot of different channels. We make use of our own products, we do user interviews, we do surveys. We try to make use of data where available. We have betas as well. Like we know we want to build a feature, we know there are certain users interested in it, we will reach out to them, ask them like, hey, would you be interested in trying this out? And then we enable the feature for them. Then we will try to see like how they are using the feature, how they like it. So it's through a lot of different channels. And our user researcher, Anna, is over there. She's the...
Anna, could you stand out and wait?
So for more information, yeah, she can her. Give you a great answer later on. Yeah.
Yes. Okay. Interestingly, there's also a question from someone sent over the email, Samantha. I don't know what's the language, Samantha was asking, what's the kind of best practice and methods to sort of keep everything consistent, because you have like designers all around the world, right?
Yeah.
Even designers working in five, six different scrum teams.
Yeah.
Yeah, how do we keep things consistent in styles or approach or?
Yeah, we have a style police. No, I'm just kidding. So we have a front-end pattern library team. Our front-end pattern is called Garden. So essentially we have a Garden team consisting of one designer and one front-end developer. They maintain and facilitate conversations around global design patterns. And that team is growing. You know, Airbnb, I visited them before, they have like 10 people like just doing that. We are not as big as them yet, so what happens is that when we have we need to create a new pattern, then like it starts from somewhere, like one project or one particular feature needs this pattern, and then what the designer would do is work with the front-end developer to say what's the best way to go about it and whether this should or should not be a new pattern. And if it is, then it's on the designer to reach out to the global team and say, hey, how, like for example, I was working on pagination pattern, right? How do you do pagination across the board now? You know, and we do a base camp post. And then, you know, some people might do pagination, some people might do lazy loading, or any other techniques, right? And we try to find a way to consolidate and work out like what's the best way going forward. So it typically I'll make a post and I'll give it a few days like for people to comment, and then after that we wrap up. And if we're unable to wrap up, Nicolette, our designer in SF. She's a garden designer. So what she'll do is she'll help to summarize everything and then like make sure that the conversation reaches a conclusion. And once that is done, then it's open to be added to the library, either as a React component or.
So I heard Basecamp. So is that how designers work within, or everyone in Zendesk uses Basecamp too?
Designers, and that's open to people in Zendesk as well.
I think otherwise our standard software for collaboration is the usual Jira, Confluence, Google Docs, all those stuff.
So for designers, it's really scary.
Yeah.
She's a very big conference fan.
Documentation, yes, very important.
Her nickname is the Chief Documentation Officer. Yes.
It's important when your team grows big enough, like documentation really makes a difference. I look back at documentation that I wrote 3 years ago, and I'm like, oh my goodness, you're so smart to write this documentation 3 years ago. I thank you so much.
Yeah, because a lot of times, like from work, when I joined, I was like, how does everything work, right? And that documentation is very good in the sense that you can just go in and like, it's basically like a company wiki, right? And a lot of times, a lot of this knowledge is tribal knowledge, and what you need is something that is written down on pen and paper, because like tribal knowledge is not reliable. Like I can ask somebody, so what happened? What is the decision? How did you get to that? And then they're like, oh, I forgot. It's like check the confluence.
And of course, this leads to Basecamp being. Will that also be the tool that you guys will run design critiques on?
We tend to do design critiques face to face or through video calling. Yeah. Sometimes we do use Basecamp, so it's a mix of face-to-face video and the software. So I find that like when you work remotely, the most important thing is not the software that you use, but really like the rhythm or cadence in which you want to get that feedback. So for us, we have every week it's internally within Singapore, and then every second week it's with Melbourne office as well. So we have some sort of like a APAC, sort of like critique group. Just because like we're just 2 hours apart in terms of time zone. Then Europe, they have one, and then SF, you know, they have on their side as well.
So that's when designers kind of like look at each other's design or comment on.
Yeah, exactly. Mm. So we have this spreadsheet template, right, that we fill in. So there's like one section is like 5 minute updates, so everybody can like say what they'll be working on and give an update on their product that they'll be working on for the week. And then the other section is like a 15 minute critique. Hey, if you're stuck or you need some feedback or some ideas, you can use that time to gather that feedback. Yeah.
Okay. So, any? Yes.
I guess as your users grow, you will have different. You will start to see different kind of users. Some may have more basic flows. Some may have more advanced flows, and they could conflict with each other. So, how do you resolve and balance out the different kind of user groups?
Enterprise question.
So Mike, I think just now he mentioned something about like enterprise. So that's a very interesting point, because I'm sort of the enterprise chat designer. That actually resonates very strongly with us. So Pen was built for small medium businesses, and now that we are part of Zendesk, we are also targeting the enterprise market, which I think for people who do know Zendesk, we target quite a wide range of businesses. So how we approach that is we are very greedy. We try to address the whole market. We want to capture everyone from small, medium businesses all the way to enterprises. And what that means to us is simply, I think we just have to be very disciplined to really, really understand, okay, we know the SMB market well. Now we are trying to get into the enterprise market. What do we know about the SMB? What do we know about enterprises? Where are the overlaps? Enterprise, I think there's this perception as well that enterprises, they just want a lot of features, their workflows are necessarily very complex. It's really not true. What we found out is that it's really not true. The enterprises actually also want simple workflows. They just don't know how to articulate it. But because they have deep pockets and they have very loud voices, they were just like, yeah, we want this feature, this feature, this feature, this feature. But when you get to the root of the problem, actually everybody wants the same thing. They all want simple workflows. They want things to be easy. So there are still slight differences in terms of like how they operate. But when we get to the root of the problem, like we really understand our users, it's we just try to merge everything together. Yeah. Does that make sense? I'm not sure it does.
Design-wise, there are a couple of things that you can do, like some principles you can stick to, like you know, progressive disclosure. So 80% of people want it simple, so you like make those controls easily accessible, and then if they want more advanced features, they can dig deeper and it's hidden away somewhere, like for example. But design, other than design-wise, like I think the product manager plays a very important role in helping to figure out So, do you want to talk a little bit about how Rajat filters some of those things?
So I mentioned I'm focused on chat enterprise. I paired up with two excellent product managers who have to deal with all those enterprise customers and poor things, they have to stay up very late sometimes to field calls and whatnot. So what they do is basically they are very disciplined they are very, very disciplined in what they listen to, what they accept. And as product managers, I think they're just very good at being firm about saying no. And then it's about building their relationship with that enterprise customer, saying like, okay, we hear you, we understand you, we feel your pain, but this might not work. And let me give you an example of how this other enterprise customer is dealing with the problem. And we try to build a relationship over there as well. So when it comes to enterprises, it's also about, because there are fewer enterprise customers, it's possible for us to build that deeper relationship to be able to teach them as well. And like, hey, you know, this workflow, we know you have this for many years, but would you mind trying this other workflow, for example? We've seen this work out somewhere else. So when it moves on to the enterprise space, we found that it is also a bit of a two-way education. They give us their feature requests, we teach them how to be more efficient as well. Yeah.
And Google Drive and everything, there are a lot of tools that we can use to improve our working abilities. But what I'm thinking about is, if we are not in a same physical space, then I feel that it's very difficult to get a more relationship with our colleagues, you know, because in a same space, we can host some events to get people together, eat together, share everything. So how do you think about to remote work for remote work, but to get people get more deep relationship with the colleagues?
So it's remote work relationship building in a remote environment.
So my first job was as a remote worker, and I've run into a lot of those problems before. So what I found is that you need to make trips, like every quarter, 2 months or every half a year even, just to have that face-to-face like human connection. And when you are there with them, concentrate on building the relationship as opposed to doing work, because the work you can do it while you are here, right? And I think the challenge comes when if everybody is working remotely, it's very easy. But the challenge comes from when half the team is, you are remote and the other team is, they have colleagues there on location as well, right? So they could have conversations there and then they forgot to update you and then you are being left out. Or the other way around, like, applies as well, right? So I think the couple of things that you can do most immediately, like tactically, is like just having some kind of log of like what you've been doing and working on. What I do is Is Michael Ong here?
No.
not sad. He okay, so he taught me this. So like having Google Slides and then like every day like what you do, just like log in so that when they when you have people who not okay with you day to day, like maybe they check in like every few days or every month or every quarter even, they can sort of like see what is going on. If they can dive into it like, if they want to without having to set up a call with you. But yeah, having a daily sync up I think works very well as well. As a designer, having a daily call, just 15 minutes, sometimes you might have things to say, sometimes you might not have things to say. But I found that, for example, if you have a daily sync with a product manager or the product owner, if you're doing client services, that really helps a lot. Even if it's 5 minutes, like, hey, 10 a.m. every day, 5 minute like sync. I think that works. So yeah, so in terms of like documentation and all that, there's like Google Slides and all that things you can do. I found that the further you are, the more documentation you need. And the writing and documentation is important, especially if you're speaking different languages. So I used to work with developers in Romania, South Africa, you know, Vietnam, and what I found is that they don't perform as well when we do calls, but if you write an email, they are doing Google Translate like, on your stuff, right? So so that's why I learned. But the most important thing is to have that rhythm of like being constantly connected to your teammates.
To add on to that a little bit, I think those are great tips. I faced that problem recently as well. Actually not recently. I've been facing that problem for quite a while. I mean, since we are a remote team. I think it depends a lot on the remote setup that you're in. Like for us, we have teams of different people. We have teams of designers all around the globe. So it's like, it's not like you're alone, you're the one person in this remote country, and then naturally people will forget you. We are a team, so it's harder to forget us. So I think there are a lot of challenges with remote work. And I don't really know how to start to answer that question, because there are things like time zone, communication style, cultural differences, documentation, like so many different things. I don't really know how to answer that question. I think it's to be creative and just like figure out like, oh, we have time zone differences, like let's find a compromise. Maybe this time I wear the pajamas, next time you wear the pajamas when you're talking to me. It's like, I think trying to be creative, be understanding to finding like what the compromises are, and like just openly saying like, hey, this really isn't working out for me, I have a family, or like I have my own life, I can't do this, and yeah, just finding different ways to deal with it. Because I think remote setups for different companies are quite different as well. Yeah.
So you got a very nice sweat water bottle, right? Yeah. So for those who asked questions earlier on, Anna? Yeah, go to Anna to pick up your water bottle. Okay, so any more from the ground? Wow.
Everybody wants a water bottle. Oh, I'll take the learning one. Easy question.
Not easy.
Spend a lot of time, chunk up time, like just to do like reading, catching up, subscribing to people on Twitter, sidebar.io, like get to know the latest trends and what's happening, and some of the emerging skills that you think you need, like from like now animation and prototyping. Animation is very important, like a lot of people using Principle and all that kind of tools. So I've been trying to pick that up a little bit as I go along as well. And you know, on Slack, everybody will just be, it helps to have colleagues who are like, you know, have the same values as you towards like learning and self-improvement, who are passionate about the craft. So I'd be sharing links and all that, like, you know, during the night or whatever, as well. I think side projects are a very nice way to learn if you have the time for it. Just trying out new things. Yeah, going for courses. And yeah, generally just trying to play around with stuff. Tinkering. Yeah. Podcast? Oh yeah, I do. So Design Details is one of the podcasts that that helped me learn a lot about like how do designers in Silicon Valley, they work, what's their lifestyle like, what do they do in order to improve. And that's when I learned, oh, a lot of them are doing side projects and all that kind of stuff. Yeah, audiobooks, listen to during my commute as well. Audiobooks are more about, so here's the thing, right? So what I thought about, like, so far has just been the technical aspects, right, of design. But as a designer, I believe that you can't be just like sitting at a computer and pushing pixels. I think a huge part of it, like 50% or more of that, is because like what you are making is just a means to an end. Like for me, I think it's just a artifact to start a conversation. And what's important as a designer is to then take that and like, you know, like facilitate the conversation around that. And so a lot of like audiobooks that I listen to has been around like even like business things, right? And like, you know, facilitation and all this kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I guess I'm supposed to take the challenge question.
Well, you can, yeah.
I don't know, so many things. I think designing as a career is by itself very challenging. It's by nature a very introspective career. You have to be very, very critical. So, like, I don't know whether this is just me or whatnot, but I feel like I'm always criticizing myself over every single thing that I do. So there are so many challenges. Which one do I talk about? I don't know. The people, I guess. That's been challenging people since day one, all the way until now. Like, but there are different kinds of people challenges. From the start, it's like, how do I work? How do I even start working in a full-time job? And then after that, it's like, how do I work in a feature team? And after that, it's like, how do I lead my feature team to craft better features? And after that, it's like, now how do I help to mentor people? How do we as a team start to champion things? So I think the challenge throughout my whole career has really been understanding people, because design by itself is a very human craft. And actually that ties back into, I think, learning. So there are many, many different tracks for designers to grow into. I think you can like specialize into like the software, the visual, the user research and whatnot. But I don't know, like after 4 years, I just feel like everything ties back again to people. And to be a better designer, I just feel like you have to be very, very broad-based. You have to be interested in everything. Like recently, I don't know why, I started getting interested in microbiology and what? And parasites. It's very fun. And neuroscience. And I thought, maybe because of the parasites, that's how we think. And maybe that's how our cultures are formed. And it's like, how does that influence design? I don't know, like, those questions to me are also very challenging. I don't really know how to answer them. Because it's so broad and... Yeah, but I think it all ties back to people. Design is all about people. Yeah.
I'll give you one, if we have the... So, I've been running a design studio for 4 years, right? And I said I spent a lot of the later years being a business person. So the challenge for me has been my design skills are rusty, now, and how do I get back those skills, right? And it didn't help that like I spent most of last year essentially sort of like not working because the pregnancy was complicated. So I spent a lot of time in the hospital, and then so when I came back to work, a lot of my skills I found was like a bit rusty, the thinking, like, because yeah, that's part of like small business and enterprise as well, is that you don't make decision and convince people by like, hey, can I, let's do this, you know, but have to argue like, you know, what's the best thing to do by logic or give a very good reason to do it. And I found that my brain was just not up to the task for that. So yeah, that's been one of the challenges. And like, to overcome this, you just have to like keep doing. And luckily I have very supportive colleagues here that you know, have like, I can ask for feedback, like a lot of, like, any time that you want, you can just like pop by, like, hey, can I disturb you? Like,
cannot.
Yeah, but still, yeah, can you tell me about this or that? Yeah, so I think having that group and peer support is important for that as well. Yeah.
So we've been talking about people, right? And what do you look for, or what do you guys look for when we want people to be in the Zendesk team?
We wanted to not be too to say like we are hiring, but yeah, we are hiring. since this question popped up anyway, yeah, Corina, our tech recruiter, is somewhere, just nearby. What do we look for in people?
We look for designers that are very thoughtful, willing to, when being able to break down a design problem, like analyzing like what exactly is the kind of problem that we're solving, and then taking the effort to then explore like all the different like ideas or all the different like scenarios that could possibly happen. Yeah, a lot of the time we kind of face our interviewees like by throwing them a lot of like what if scenarios. And we like people who have already done the homework, for example, and then like to show that, oh, they've already thought about all these like many different scenarios and able to come up with an answer as and when. What else?
I think thoughtful, very broad people. Because of the way we are structured, we are more generally looking for people who can do UI, UX, if that's what we are still calling them. We look for people who can do both. We look for people whom we feel have the same values as us, like not too, how do I say?
Be interested in microbiology.
Yeah.
Yeah, possible, plus.
You guys did that.
I think we look for people who are very strong communicators as well, and who seem to give a damn about people. Yeah. Mm. It's very hard to find out in the interview, but yeah, we try to look for people who give a damn.
I think you sort of feel it, right? Like whether...
We ask situational questions.
You kind of, sometimes you can feel like the passion that people have for... it's not just a job, but it, you know, like gives meaning to... like the life, if they have $1 billion, they don't need to work, they will still be doing design, right? I think that's important.
So to sum up, broad-based, thoughtful, strong communicator, cares about
empathetic
people.
Yeah, empathetic.
Okay, you
had
a question, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Who calls the cards often? I mean, do your designs get rejected, and then engineering calls the shots on your design instead? So in this conference, designers rule, obviously. But in real life, that's true outside of this room.
Well, you know, no design ever survives engineer critique.
Yeah, there are engineers in the room, by the way.
So I find that our office is pretty unique, even among Zendesk itself, as pretty balanced between the PM engineering and the designers, what you call the PED triumvirate, right? And this is, I think it was a result of like the, you know, Zopim designers in the past, because what they've done has been hugely influential in the success of the company. So there's a lot of respect for the designers. At the same time, we have a lot of engineers who are very passionate about design, and they will not like sweat like the small like details. They will go down into the pixels and all that. So a lot of times, a lot of engineers are very very UX aware as well. So even things like walking through like certain behaviors that a system is supposed to have, we just sit down and like ping a few like scenarios and how should it behave and all that. A lot of times it's like just working together on it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes.
Kind of get the gist from all your answers, but what would be the design process if you had to explain that in the Zendesk? Is there a method?
There's a method?
It's the standard one, but a lot more chaotic than the textbook version. I think what we are all taught is like, oh, you must do research first, understand the problem, then what was next? Ideate, explore, then you go build prototypes and figure out the final solution. I think that's the textbook ideal way that we are all learning, and that's what I teach in my classes as well. But obviously,
yeah, Shui is a lecturer at NTU.
Part time. But of course, the real world process is a lot more chaotic and disorganized, because who can really perform that in the real world? Yeah, that's the ideal one. We try to match it. We never do.
Mm.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, throughout the years, I've been a student of many methodologies. I find that a lot of these methodologies are marketing gimmicks, right? So you have...
Let's call them guidelines.
Design thinking is basically a marketing gimmick for IDEO, right?
You should have checked before you see
it. Well, they closed down now, so it's okay. You know, then you have Lean Startup, which is help Eric Ries sell books and have like, you know, speaking gigs and all that. And then you have Lean UX and Agile UX, right? And all these kind of things. And what I realized was that a lot of these are, yes, the scientific method, yes, the industrial design method, then you know, a lot of the principles are the same, like essentially. So it really is about, yeah, I know you have Google Design Sprint, right? Wow, okay. But yeah, so design has not changed since you know, the early 19th century or 20th century. I went to an Eames exhibition. So Eames is this like famous pair of furniture designers, husband and wife. And I realized a lot of the things that they do are quite similar. Like it's parallel to what we do, right? A lot of it is thinking about the people, thinking about their needs, and then prototyping a shit ton of prototypes, right? And then just making sure that you are experimenting and failing a lot of time, like throw stuff out there and see what works. And I think that in essence is the core of every design process, no matter the name. So if you, I guess like design is very synonymous with prototyping. Is my, after many years of thinking about all this like stuff.
One more point to add. I think the one thing that we really value a lot here is that the design process isn't for designers, it's for the whole functional team. So when we talk about advertising, ideation prototyping, like a lot of engineers, for example, they want to jump into the late night calls, they want to jump in to all those ideation sessions. They're very happy. They seem very happy when we do ideation sessions, I hope. Yeah, so it's a whole team effort. It's not one, it's not, oh, I'm the designer, I know this.
So essentially this culture and values of appreciating design, product design across not just designers themselves, but you know, engineers and product managers is key to success.
Yeah, I mean, like, user experience is not just the purview of a designer, right? How can you be so arrogant as to say, yeah, it's just the designer's responsibility and everything I do is the equation experience called designer, right? I mean, there are things like the load time, like how fast the app is, like whether it actually has been crashing or not, or even things like the customer support. When people have problems and they reach to your customer support, you know, how fast do they take to respond? Are they friendly? Do they phrase their words in a very polite way, or is it like very curt? How long you you know, wait until they get back to you, follow up and all this kind of thing. I think it all adds up to like customer experience or user experience, right? So in a sense, it's not just design, it's the responsibility of the whole team to, you know, to get a good experience for our customers.
Yes.
I mean, yeah, talking about culture, right, I think it's really important. So I'm curious, when you guys came from different starting points, right? For yourself, it was in the early stages where it was early open, and for yourself, running your own design studio, right? So what is one healthy habit when it comes to perhaps learning or teamwork that you guys have brought and infused into the current team and the life of this?
You're talking Creative Friday.
Habit.
Then you're
brought from that.
Yeah,
I think you should.
I wouldn't be so bold to say that we infuse. We more like, I think it's more of a team effort. I think there were several things that got carried over from the Zoten days. Mike reminded me about one cool thing called the Creative Friday, which was started by one of our senior designers, Ting Wan. So every alternate Friday, we will try to do something totally unrelated to our work. That's one thing that we've brought over from Zoten days into Zendesk days. A lot of Zendesk offices are very envious of this thing, and they keep trying to do it, but they don't succeed. I think that's one habit. I think what made that valuable was
during our Creative Friday?
Oh yeah, so what we do for some of the Creative Fridays would be like, for example, we have paper plane competitions, we have, when we get lazy and no one wants to plan, we have silent reading time where everybody just gets a book and you read for 1 hour. When we get really lazy, we're just like, okay, let's do food appreciation day and we go to a nearby restaurant or something like that and we eat. Now for like fun ones, we try to get involved people. Like recently, there was this session called Draw Your Ideal, Fill in a Blank. So yeah, we do weird, quirky stuff like that. I think that it may sound insignificant, but I think it helped to keep us grounded and remind ourselves, like, yeah, work is work, but try to bring your whole selves to work. Work should be fun. You're spending most of your time in work. Be engaged in your work. Love your work. I mean, not like we're forcing everybody to stay until like from 10 to 10, nothing that we, but we're just trying to remind people, like, you should be having fun in your work. That's when the ideas will come. That's when that's when products get better. Like your colleagues. Try to like your colleagues as much as possible, for example.
I think you find out a lot more about your colleagues when you do those activities. I found out a lot about my colleagues during the sketching session. So one of our PMs drew like a Voldemort and then drew like, you know, the Iron Throne from Game of Thrones. And I realized that, oh, she's actually secretly a villain. So things like that, pretty like quirky and no more about college for that.
One question from
that
side, yes.
What do you consider to be an essential skills that you need to have for a designer, as in interaction and UI UX, especially
for all the newcomers entering the industry, what are some of the important skills, right, or traits that you need to have?
I think it depends on what job or that you're applying for, that you want to get into, and also the skills that you think you will have potential to succeed in, like what talents that you have, for example. So for example, for me, I'm not so good with the visual side of things, but I can do the interaction part of it very well. So like focus on developing that, and then seeing like you gotta match like the kind of like company what they need with like matching with what you can do as well, right? So yeah, for example, like the first in my first job, I was working with a designer who was a very good visual designer. So then I asked him, hey, can you make all these like UI components for me, like one file, right? And then from there, I could start to create like different features based on those like components. So I might not have visually created the look and feel, but I could take those and like expand upon all the components or pages or what. So it really depends on like what you're good at, who your idols are, who you want to emulate. I think it's important as well, because like as you know, when you're starting out, it, until you find your own voice or style, like you know, idols are you know, who you look up to and try to emulate, right? Skills.
Yeah, I think those were all very good points. Look at the job description, see what they're looking out for, and then figure out whether like what try to understand what exactly are they trying to communicate and what values or qualities are they trying to look out for.
What about if a lot of times they ask for unicorn and
the company probably doesn't know what it's looking out for. Or maybe they are like a startup lah. Yeah.
I think a lot of people copy and paste.
Sorry, not.
A lot of people copy and paste the job description, right? Yeah. So you really got to go in and talk. And it's an interview, yes, but you also must interview the company and the person that you'll be working with and reporting to. Like, what is their view on design and what do they think that they need? And if you have the chance, talk to the engineers as well. Like, how can you learn from them? I think that's very important for product design. And how receptive open are they to suggestions, and have they ever worked with a designer before? I think that's pretty important as well. So really just like do your homework and get a feel and ask a lot of questions. Like don't paise, just like, sorry, don't be embarrassed. I mean, like just like ask them a lot of questions.
I think again, I think it goes back to like, caring about people, good communication style, attitude. I think those are like the basic. I think caring about people is probably the most important. Like being a designer is all about people. If you don't like working with people, if you don't enjoy working for people, working with people, then it's not really a career suited for.
Wow, a lot of questions from this side. That's why I hate keep looking at you. I need to look here. Any questions from this side? Yes.
Can you share a bit more about how you collaborate with UX researchers?
How you collaborate with UX researchers?
Anna, could you come up, please?
How do we collaborate with you?
Oh, usually we talk to Anna.
I think in Zendesk it's very interesting because Anna is our one and only UX researcher. So she literally can call herself the VP of research, the intern, no, she's not an intern anymore. The VP of research, director of research, everything research. Yeah, she's the everything research person.
What do they research?
Yeah, so she's the user researcher, official title is user researcher. I think the question was about how do we collaborate with user researchers. So with one Anna, and 20 product designers, she can't help us with all our products. So I think Anna's role is more like a consultant to us. We actually do the research ourselves. We run it with ourselves with our whole Scrum team. And then when we find ourselves like stuck or we don't know how to proceed, we go to Anna, ask Anna for help, ask Anna for advice. And then Anna will put on her wise Anna hat and start to point out, like, you know, you can do this. How about you do this? Why don't you try this? Yeah. She's our user researcher consultant as well. So the question was whether we do more qualitative or quantitative. At this point in time, I think we do more on the qualitative side. We're trying to get more into the quantitative side. But it's a little challenging because for chat itself, Zopin was built on a proprietary front-end framework. So it's actually hard to build add-on like those data tracking stuff for us. So it's a constant ongoing effort to get more data. We do have like some user data here and there, some metrics, whatnot, but we're not very good at quantitative yet.
Yeah, you want to know a challenge that is one of the challenges. Legacy.
Okay. Yes. Jules.
Was it Jules?
Yeah. I would like to know how you guys deal with and give feedback to your peers, to your bosses.
Okay. It depends on the context. So in your mind, what is the context or example?
Perhaps with your teammates, where you show them your work and then you have to give it, they have to give it back to you, and then likewise, give your feedback to them. And how do you deal with it in your own mind when you get bad and good feedback?
In my own mind, all feedback is valid. I don't defend. If they say something, I'll just, keep that in mind. But granted, you have to filter out that as well. Right? So you gotta, have your own opinion on how it's gonna be like, and sort of like be the summarizer of all the feedback. When you ask for feedback, you need to be very intentional about what kind of feedback that you want to get, right? The worst thing to do is, hey, what do you think? right? You have to like be specific about, hey, here's where my mind is at, my thoughts A, B, C, and that's how I got to here. What I do have, challenges. I'm not sure whether there'll be use cases where this could work, or do you have any ideas about like how to scale this up to like 1,000 people? I'm not sure whether that would, or global design pattern, right? Do you think this will work for your product? You know, that's a lot of the kind of feedback that we try to gather as well. So it really have to be very open-minded, have to be very intentional about what kind of research, feedback that you want to get. Most of all, try to detach yourself emotionally from the work, right? And that will help a lot, right? Don't treat the thing that you're making as a piece of art. Because you're not an artist, right? Designer is solving a business problem, right? And it's not about self-expression. It's about, in the end, like, what is a good product, right? And good product is not a pixel-perfect sketch mock-up or Photoshop mock-up. It is the discussions and all that, the consensus that you build, and then validation of the users based on, you know, your prototype or envision mockup, and you know, from there, driving those conversations out of that. Yeah. So yeah, I don't see the work as being done when you finish the design. It's only just begun after you've done that. Yeah.
It gets easier in practice. A lot easier. Like when I first started, I was like, oh, my negative feedback. I was like, oh, they're trashing me. But after a while, you just be like, oh, okay,
if you want to know more about how to work remotely and with remote stakeholders and all that, talk to Michael. Yeah. I learned everything from him.
Okay, we are almost running out of time. Shall we just have one last question? Yes, Esther.
So, you guys mentioned that you were working with the Scrum team, right? So, like the team of a lot of developers, engineers, and Scrum product managers. So, I'm just thinking, how do designers fit in the agile process?
Mm. How do designers fit into the agile process?
Zobim tried. This goes back to Zobim. Zobim tried adopting Agile, I think around 3 years ago. Like, when we first started out, I really, really tried to believe in it. Tried so hard. And I think there are lines to be drawn. Like, I think Agile works better when the company or the product is younger. But when you have an established product, you have a lot of legacy, you have so many users, it doesn't, I found that it doesn't really work that well. Because like when we come up with ideas, we come up with like, oh, different solutions, and then to actually build a good working prototype, well, actually engineers, then we find out like, oh, we go to engineers, we try like, hey, can we prototype this? And we find out, oh, actually there needs to be like some don't know how many infrastructural changes that will take 5 weeks, then we're like, oh, forget it, never mind. Then let's just try a beta, we try to hope for the best, we try to hope that we are heading in the best direction. So for me, we really, really tried Agile, we really tried it so hard, it just didn't work out for Chat, because Chat is such an, Zobim or Chat, it's such an established product. It's just, when designing, you have to care about like, oh, we have this plan, and then we have this other feature that will collect with this feature, and then we have this and this, and then it's just very hard to get into Agile in that situation.
Then why do we still do it?
I think we call it Agile, but it's not really Agile. I hope the engineers don't bash me.
Fragile?
Like, we do like the Scrum meetings and whatnot,
by using the rituals.
I think we use modified Agile that suits us.
Yeah. I think some teams are more strict on Agile. They do estimation and then burn down chart and all that kind of stuff. I think there's this, yes, building is good for building new product, but doesn't necessarily mean that it's good for startup. Because I've seen clients in the past that are very big companies, they do that as well. But yeah, then again, thinking back, they are building a new product. But it was like enterprise level, like very big company. How a designer can fit in is, so there are, I believe, two different modes of operation. Like, one is the conceptual visioning part, and I think that part has to be a few sprints ahead. And that's when you figure things out and do the fail at a time, right? As a designer, as a role in an agile team, is you are the person in front failing everything until you get to the one thing that kind of works, and then they can start implementing that already. So the second mode of operation would be, as they're implementing that, you are the one like supporting. So during that time, a lot of your designs, that's when you realize that, hey, there's X and Y and Z like use cases that I didn't think of, or like there's some edge cases, like for example, what happens if you get disconnected, you know, what happens if empty states and all that kind of stuff, right? So during that phase is when I find it useful to be sitting like right next to the engineers, and then they can just pop by and say, hey Mike, I'm missing this icon, can you like do something about it? Or like, hey, there's been like things that we haven't thought about, like, oh, okay. Like then you so yeah, basically you have to switch between those two modes and really be have to plan it properly, like, and also like given at the same time there might be some projects they're working on that are in the execution implementation stage, and then at the same time there are things that are conceptual, so just have no like what kind of mode you're operating that for, which project, and like handle that properly.
So it's more like we have the big picture, then we actually start building when we have the big picture. And then for the final details, we kind of refine it over time. Like, oh, we have the big picture, let's do all the infrastructural, architectural, engineering, whatever changes. Let's try to see whether this big picture vision works. And then if it doesn't work, at least we can throw it away fairly quickly. We don't, like, we can throw it away, actually it's also not very quick. We can throw it away lah, with less pain, because we don't flesh out the final details. We get a big picture nailed down, then we, like, we go in a smaller and smaller spiral by refining the details.
Yeah, that's a nice metaphor. But essentially, you're supposed to make sure that engineer's time is not wasted, because engineer time is the most expensive time, right? So anything that you can prototype or make or do before then, it's on you to do. Yeah.
All right. So that's it. As a token of appreciation, we actually got...
We get a rooster.
Oh, yes. Yeah, where is the rooster? Okay, so, we have actually limited edition IxD Session that we use for fundraising.
Woohoo.
So one for Chili.
Thank you.
Thank you. And one for Mike. So let's give them a round of applause. Okay, so as you can see, the night is still young, and you have these labels here, right? And you guys know that it's color-coded, right? So you can still network, feel free to stay around, chat with people that you would like to speak with in the right colors. Yeah, and see you next month, right? Thank you.